Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to episode 98 of the Yin and the Yang podcast. And of course, this show is powered by More Enterprises in association with Anti-USW Productions. And as promised, today's episode, ladies and gentlemen, is an important one, as the fate of this show will be decided by you, the listener, you, the Galaxian. Yes, you, the Yin and the Yang galaxy. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a call to action, because this show decides the fate of our future shows. It decides whether the show will either sink or swim. And as we are at a do or die moment here, as promised, we will put our best foot forward to provide you with the absolute best that we can in mixed martial arts, health, fitness, and motivation. All, and I mean all, of your favorite segments will be back today. And all of our interns are sitting back in the sound booth with Huang right now as we speak. They're eating up all the goodies back there, all the Halloween candy back there. At the same time, ladies and gentlemen, there are some special guests that are back for this episode. We cannot say exactly who. However, some have passed on, Mr. Perot. All right. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we will hopefully broadcast to you episode 99, but right now, that's not what it's about. It's about what's at hand right now. And on today's episode, Dwayne The Rock Johnson invades MMA, a controversial finish to the BMF fight this past Saturday. Vegans have a strike against them when it comes to memory. Six bodybuilding tips from the man himself, Arnold Schwarzenegger, a special article that was sent in by one of our listeners. And we honor the 25th anniversary of what is highly regarded as one of the best martial arts dramas in the history of film, known as The Best of the Best. Can you believe that? It turns 25. And to bring in my co-host for this adventure, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to cue up his music. And what we're about to play, I don't give a damn if we get thrown off the airwaves, because if this is our last episode, we're going to go out in style. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to bring into you Mr. Co-host, my co-host, Mr. Co-host to you, actually. He is the former owner of the More Family Network of podcasts before BDM took his entire empire. And Lord knows whether he'll ever get it back. Ladies and gentlemen, he is Larry. I have winged it for 97 episodes with no knowledge. 100 can't come any quicker. Larry, I have voted today. Larry, I have a black belt in Icon Udo Mormon.
All right, we're going to pay big bucks to make sure that that makes it to the airwaves. What's going on, Yin and Yang universe? We are back, episode 98, the pinnacle. This is the one, folks. We need this. It is sink or swim. Anthony, how you doing today?
Larry, I am doing absolutely phenomenal. Thank you for asking. I've had an amazing week so far. Traveled out to Pittsburgh to go see the Steelers play the Colts. Came back with a win for the Steel City. And I am riding high right now. I was all nervous all week about doing this episode because, honestly, man, I don't even know what to think right now. A lot of emotions are running. Now, don't rub your eyes, Larry. Now, I know you want to throw your ticker tape parade. This is not the time.
No, it's not that type of episode. It's going to be a good episode. Listen, you rock. You are one of the best podcasters right now on the More family of podcasts. And I'm telling you that I'm shooting from the hip. You are one of the best. When you guest on the Better Half or the Retro Gamers, you shine. Today, my friend, this is you. You will shine today. By God Almighty, you will shine today.
I certainly hope that you're absolutely right, brother, because the fate of this show, this is interesting. I'm glad that you attended the production meeting when we had to go to More Enterprises this past weekend. On Saturday, actually, we were summoned to go up there by BDM personally. We met with the investors. The investors want double numbers on listens and downloads on our home base of Spreaker. Personally, I really feel that the fans can pull this off. I really feel that the fans will have the ability, okay, to send it out to their friends, send it out to their families, and have their friends and family send it out to their friends and family, and so on and so forth. And we can get double digits so that we can be – and I was told by – there's a hot rumor going around on more enterprises that if we make it towards episode 100, there is a huge possibility that several things can happen. Number one, money will be poured into investing in the show.
About time. Okay.
To become better. Okay. And I could go a thousand ways to play the blame game on you when you first had that.
It's not that type of episode. What are you doing?
It's not. You're right. No, I'm just saying. Okay. And secondly, allow me to also say, ladies and gentlemen, that for the most part, they have also mentioned to me that we may have overseas investors who actually like the show, which will be great. That sounds really good. And last but not least, Larry, we promise the fans that we will do an absolute best to our ability professional show. All the interns are sitting in the back. Do you see them? They're sitting in the back.
Yeah, there's a few.
Now.
Where'd you find half of them? I could have sworn.
Winston, Buddy, Claudio, Huang. They're all hanging out back there eating all the Halloween candy.
Wasn't Buddy hanging out underneath the train trestles there for a little while?
I don't know, man, but he's back there.
Where'd you find him?
He was supposed to be your personal security. Now, all of a sudden, he gained about 50, 60 pounds. So whatever weight I lost, he found.
There you go.
All right. And Tara was supposed to be here, but the lucky ladies would not allow her to leave.
This is true. That's okay. But
ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, we're ready to go. Let's do this.
How was your week, man?
My week was good. My week was good. You know, did a lot of podcasting. I'm setting up for some stuff down the road. Attended Monday Night Raw at the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum, NYCB Live, home of the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum. Just had a really good time, relaxed, played some Luigi's Mansion 3, and just kind of kicked it old school.
Absolutely. And that's, you know, what it's all about. I was going to attend, but unfortunately some my scheduling just did not allow me to attend. I was told that my favorites were there. Unfortunately, I just couldn't make it. And that's what December 20th at the Barclays Center will be. Hopefully, if they still have the tag titles. Hopefully, if there are certain people that will be shooken up. I would love to see exactly. Okay.
Smackdown.
This NXT invasion, and what's going to happen with it. Will some people move up the roster? That would be pretty awesome. But it's not about, and that would be, I'm sure, one of those major things that you'd be talking on that show every periodical Saturday.
Which show is that again?
Larry? Talking More Wrestling.
Yes, it might be coming back as a video production. We'll see. There's some stuff in the air about that. Actually, in a couple weeks, I'll be recording episode 3 of The Ring Crew, and we'll be talking about the NXT invasion and all Survivor Series.
Wait a minute. How is it that this show has been going on longer than Talking More Wrestling, and yet you're getting video for that show, and this show has gone almost 100 episodes, and we have not seen 1 second of video?
Well, you've posted video before.
And Larry, the 2 times that you were on video,
we got a lot of hits.
We got a lot of hits because you were angry. You were also filthy rich. You also, the second time, tried to flip the bill to me. If I didn't raise my voice, you would have really left.
And if you didn't raise your voice, that bit would have been a whole lot better. But, you know, that's not what this episode is all about.
You tried to run out on the bill. That's exactly what you did.
You never admit fault, Ken. This is not what the episode's about. Let's get into it, because I'm very interested in hearing about The Rock at Madison Square Garden.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, at the top of the hour here, our major, major story is that for those of you who did not see UFC 244, allow me to say that it was one hell of an interesting evening with a lot of knockouts. The big boys came out to play for sure, and we're not talking about WCW. We are talking about the BMF, the Bad Motherfucker title.
Yeah, what was that all about?
Was out there now.
Is that like an official title?
Okay, so first and foremost, allow me to say that this is not an official title.
Okay.
This is a stupid concept.
It's like the million-dollar belt.
Created. It's kind of like the million-dollar belt. Exactly, right? Basically, what the title is about is basically Nick Diaz, the baddest motherfucker, you know, on the planet, in the world of MMA, and Jorge Masvidal is a guy who comes out of straight out of Miami. He actually was, I think, like a part of, not part of, but he was around Kimbo Slice's crew.
Okay. Right?
When Kimbo was doing street fighting, because they both come from the 305, and then he transitioned to MMA, just like Kimbo did. God bless Kimbo. And because we always pay our respects to Kimbo here, you know, because we're big fans. And what happened was he claimed that he was a bad mother effer. So ultimately what happened was the UFC decided, let's promote the show by creating a $50,000 belt called the Bad Motherfucker Belt. So The Rock basically wants to be the guy. He had announced it that he wanted to be the guy in the octagon who is going to wrap the belt around the waist of the winner of that fight.
I saw that, yeah.
Right, to reign as the baddest motherfucker. So, well, basically what happened was...
Oh, and you were saying before, the belt is $50,000?
Something like that. Boy. Yeah, apparently it has like this... the rumor has it was that it was around $50,000 or something like that. A piece of hardware that pretty much... Yeah, you know, because their designs are very complex now. It's not like that standard UFC that you see now. Yeah. You know, in the past, it's a very complex belt to create. It's the thickness of it. It's heavy from apparently from what people say. It's about 8 or 10 pounds.
10 pounds of gold,
apparently. Right. So ultimately, what happened was, the fight, first of all, was absolutely outstanding. But what happened was, Diaz was getting cut up so bad on the top of his right eye. Literally, he was cut open on the top and the bottom of his eye. Ooh. And what happened was you could literally see it looked like somebody just took a razor blade and cut his eyebrow, right? And the lower part of his eye. So it was pretty bad. And you know, this is the height. It's like the climax of the fight. The doctor comes in and somehow, some way, the doctor says, look, instead of wiping Diaz's face, you know, and just letting it, stopping it, trying to apply something and letting the fight go, because the fight is not a bad cut in MMA. I mean, there have been in the Ultimate Fighter season 10, for those of you who watched it, there was a guy named Abe who literally got his head split open to the point where you could see his skull. Right. I mean, and this was due to like to bottom elbows. So this cut is not that bad. He still had his vision. So the doctor comes up, and this is a doctor, I believe, that's approved by the New York State Athletic Commission, basically says, stop the fight.
That's
and
it.
The amount of and
doctor
it
stoppage.
Was the amount. Yep. Doctor stoppage, which is considered a TKO. Under the state athletic rules, and the place went berserk. If you wanted to see a literally the closest thing to happen to a riot, in This was it. Diaz was beside himself, pissed off to the degree where he was like, "What the fuck?" Because I think it was like a third round or something like that.
Oh,
right?
So it was deep into the fight.
Right, it was pretty deep into the fight. We were going to go into the championship rounds. You know, we're almost there. This fucking idiot doctor, basically, now, the story gets deeper than this. Basically, there were fans. I don't know if they were gamblers. I don't know if there were people. But people wrote in and gave this doctor death threats.
That's not good.
Okay, for stopping this fight. Because I'm sure a lot of people either invested money into it, gambled, or whatever.
Oh, okay? Just wanted to see a better ending.
Right. They wanted to see a real victor. Well, they gave this doctor death threats, and the doctor got so angry, he lashed back out at the MMA fans, and he says, look, because of you idiots, I now fear for my life and my safety. Because not only is his face exposed on TV, but now people know who he is. They know his name. They know what he does. It's crazy. Totally crazy. Because once you put yourself out there like that, now, you know, not only are you threatened, but, you know, your family could be possibly threatened verbally or physically, too.
I mean, hopefully these idiot fans won't go that far. You know, I know it's one thing to be passionate about a fight or a ball game or something like that.
Right. But I mean, for a fight, it is just crazy, you know? And these MMA fans are relentless. Oh, they are ruthless and relentless.
It was at the Garden. It was at Madison Square Garden. Right. So, you exactly. know, New York City.
Absolutely.
BMF title, is this like a Dana White thing or was it a Dwayne
Johnson
thing?
It's definitely a Dana
thing?
White okay. thing. Dwayne Johnson said that he was going to be the one who was going to wrap the title around the winner's waist, and that's all his objective was there for.
Well, right? I saw when he came out, they played his music, which I thought was pretty cool, you know, coming out to the Garden like that. Pretty sweet.
Right. So that was pretty cool. And then what happened was Diaz got angry because he's like, fuck The Rock, fuck him.
Oh, I saw that, yeah.
Right. He got angry because Masvidal was from Miami. And so Rock is from Miami as well. So he's like, oh, you know, fuck him with his camaraderie. If he wants some, he can come get some too. Now, listen, you don't want to do that to The Rock. The Rock will kill you. I don't give a shit.
The Rock's legit, man. Look, I don't care what anyone says about wrestling. The Rock is legit.
Yep. I mean, the Rock is not only legitimately big and strong, the guy is... You don't think wrestlers can defend themselves in a ring?
No.
I think he can.
No, that's one thing. I'm just saying, though, The Rock will destroy you and will destroy anybody. But let me ask you a question. Let me ask you this. Do you think The Rock, the way he is today, with his physique and his training regimen, you think it's all natural, all above the table?
Wow. That's a really
I'm calling
really
you out. I'm calling you out on it.
Okay, all right, and I'm glad you are. I'm glad that you are challenging me on this one because it's funny that you actually even asked this question because last Saturday we were talking about this earlier when we were working out in the gym, and my training partners and I we had seen the whole thing because the press conference, and we had seen The Rock come out, and you know we had. Seen pretty much like what he looks like now. Mm-hmm. And the question was at hand in the gym was, is The Rock, you know, on the juice or is he not? And honestly, I have to say to you, man, I really have a belief that he was before, right? To get to that size or to get to that, you know, the way he – not the way that he looks now, but to put on the size and the mass and stuff like that.
Yeah, because he was definitely skinnier when he first started wrestling.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And then when he started getting into movies, I think he had to project an image. Mm-hmm. So he had to project a look, a certain look. And he had to it goes back to what Terry Crews had said at one point in time, which is that if you want the world to take notice, you have to do and be something that the world has never seen before, mm-hmm. which – in Hollywood, you know, who else looks like The Rock, right?
Yeah, I mean, I agree.
There's nobody, right? So The Rock is a very unique, separate entity. Just like how many guys do you see in movies look like Terry Crews or like Arnold or like Sylvester Stallone, right? Mm-hmm. So they have to do something that makes themselves unique. Look at Jackie Chan. Jackie Chan does his own stunts. Mm-hmm. He may not be the biggest guy, but he's also one of the most popular figures in film around the world.
Oh, yeah.
He's done something different. So with The Rock, we really feel that he was on it before. Definitely for sure. He was, or either that or he was taking some HGH, which is human growth hormone, or human muscle builder, HMB, or something. He was on something, okay, whether it's legal or illegal. But now – I think he's gotten to that point where we all agreed in the gym, he's not on it anymore.
Okay.
He's just gotten to that point that he's maintaining at this point. Or he's just getting it in to make sure. Now, but also you have to remember something, okay? Somebody posed a question to me earlier. Why, you know, in the week, why is it that the average human being can't look like that? Oh, it's a very simple answer. You have to understand that The Rock's meals are cooked for him.
Oh, of course.
He has dietary experts. He has medical experts who are probably around him, mm-hmm. sports coaches, strength and conditioning coaches. I'm sure he has endurance coaches. He has a ton, like he has an entire entourage of people that are supplying him with the amount of money that he makes.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, he is basically surrounded by people who will keep him in that optimal shape. Mm-hmm. And if you think that that costs a lot, all he has to do is probably make one movie a year and he covers all those costs, right?
Which he basically does. Oh, right. I don't mean to cut you off. I'm sorry.
No.
What? He also announced he's making a movie about MMA fighter?
Yes. So The Rock is going to play the part of first of all, the movie is called The Smashing Machine. And for those of you who do not know who The Smashing Machine is, he is known as Mark Kerr. Mark Kerr was at one time the most dominant fighter that the UFC has ever seen in the heavyweight division. He never won the UFC heavyweight championship. He was trained by a guy named Mark the Hammer Coleman. And Mark Coleman is considered the father of ground and pound. Mm-hmm. And he went to UFC. He won two heavyweight tournaments. He won a trophy and everything like that. But they never gave Mark Kerr the recognition that he has or that he deserves. So Mark Kerr said, fuck it, I'm going to go to Pride FC. So for those of you who have never seen Pride, Pride was Japan's answer to UFC. And where it's not an octagon cage, they fought in a ring, mm-hmm. but they fought 10 minutes apiece.
Oof.
So 10-minute rounds, from what I understand.
Yeah.
And I think that there are 10 – I'm sorry, two or three 10-minute rounds. So a fight can go a half an hour. You know what I mean?
That's rough.
And that's very rough. You know, you would have to be in top condition. And there's an HBO documentary that came out called The Smashing Machine. And it was an award-winning documentary because even though, you know, Mark Kerr was jacked like you wouldn't believe, he also had to deal with a lot of inner demons,
mm-hmm.
A lot of painkillers, a lot of drugs, a lot of steroids, a lot of things that he was injecting into his body. He had this is a collegiate pro. I mean, this is a collegiate wrestler.
Okay.
Who went to his first MMA fights were brutal. He did the Vale Tudo, which is basically the no holds barred, bare knuckled Brazilian MMA.
Almost like UFC, like the first 10 UFC.
Right, with no control.
Yeah,
like, literally no control. At least those guys wore some sort of gloves. These guys didn't wear shit.
No, I don't think they wore gloves in the first few UFCs.
You sure?
Okay. I'm pretty sure it was bare knuckle, yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, yeah. So basically it was anything goes, and he just was so dominant. But then once he got out of rehab, when he was training with Boss Rutten, the guy was unstoppable. I mean, you're talking about a 6'4", 6'5" guy who was 265 pounds, jacked to the gills. Mm-hmm. It looked like a bodybuilder with a wrestling background is going in there. His premise was simple. What he would do is that he would, first of all, intimidate you with his size. The second is that once that bell rang, he would literally take you down on a ground and pound.
Mm-hmm.
Like he would literally take you down to the ground, get on top of you, and pound the shit out of you and stun.
Jeez.
It's a simple concept. Would it work today? No, because obviously the MMA fighter of 1999, which is when Mark Kerr's prime, is not the MMA fighter 20 years later.
No.
Right? It's the sports definitely, and the skill set has definitely evolved. But what I am trying to say to you is the idea that, it's an interesting concept. Now, to be honest with you, the way that I see it is that that's going to be an amazing movie. I heard either J-Lo or Nicole Scherzinger, who, oh my God, I'm in love with. She is amazingly fine. She may actually play Mark Kerr's wife. And Dawn Kerr is beautiful. I mean, she is absolutely beautiful. Even for her age now, she is outstanding. Mark has now he has a GoFundMe page that you all can go to. He's diagnosed with peripheral neuropathy, or something like that, which is basically like pain in your joints and bones and stuff like that. And Lord knows what it's from, but let's just put it like this. The man needs your help, you know, and he needs our help. So, I mean, it's like I donated something, to this.
Okay.
You know, because he's definitely one of my favorite fighters. So before your Fedors, your Stipe Miocics, before your John Jones, your Daniel Cormiers, there was this guy.
All right.
Mark the Smash Machine Cut.
We will be checking that out.
Oh, yeah.
When it comes down the pike. All right.
Absolutely. Brother, I have unearthed something. Remember how a few episodes ago we were talking about the whole thing about, being vegan and eating more plant-based and blah, blah, blah.
The Impossible Burger. So,
well, I don't endorse you eating that, but if push comes to shove, can't say no, right? I would say you can't say
no. It wasn't bad.
Right? Okay. The only thing that's stopping me from eating the Impossible Burger is just the salt content, which is really, really high. It's like 1,600 milligrams. Which is your daily average intake, by the way, is only supposed to be 2,300. This thing has 1,600. You're going to have to drink a lot of water, man. A lot of water.
Okay.
Well, apparently, somebody had sent me an article that states that if you are vegan, you have a higher chance of acquiring dementia.
Really?
Do you know why?
Probably because you're lacking nutrients. Well,
there's a give and take. The vegans apparently, I'm talking about strict veganism, they have lower blood pressures, lower cholesterol levels, and lower chances of diabetes and all this other crap simply because they're not taking in stuff that will potentially hurt you, right? However, the give and take here is that because they don't consume meat and because they don't consume certain nutrients like eggs, fish that are high in choline. Choline is a very important piece that it helps your liver. Well, they say apparently that meats and eggs and fish have certain things, certain elements and chemicals that are good chemicals that actually help the fat, the tissue in your brain.
Oh.
Now, if you don't consume it, guess what? Like a car, if you don't use it, you lose it.
Yeah.
So I found that to be very, very surprising.
That is
so
very odd.
I think that it would not be okay to be a – I mean, look, if you're that hardcore about it, then great. I don't think people should just eat meat only. I think that if you can find some sort of equilibrium, if you can find some sort of thing like either being a vegetarian.
Well, we're omnivores.
Maybe a pescatarian. Well, I mean, yes, we are omnivores. However, I mean, it's really what works for the human body. I mean, like, again, I think we had spoken about this before. I really think that people in, let's say, a certain country can absorb certain things that other people in other countries cannot, right? Which goes back to the whole thing about what is the best diet. There is no such thing as the best diet. You know, somebody once said, like Master Wong once said, where do you come from? What is your genetic makeup? What did your descendants eat before you did, right? So, I mean, it's an interesting thing. You know, now, here's a funny one.
Okay.
So I was looking at something called the Okinawan diet. So their diet is basically consisted of a little bit of rice, fish, and vegetables, more vegetables than anything else. And they don't eat any meat whatsoever for the entire month, except for one day when they eat all pork.
Oh.
And, okay. And then they go right back into the vegetable diet.
Interesting.
Which is crazy because the pork is some cultural concept that they have to follow.
Fair enough.
Here's the amazing thing. Okinawans average a death rate of about 90 something years old, minimal.
Wow.
And a lot of it is contributed to what they intake as well as what, you know, the kind of work that they do, because a lot of it is manual labor.
Yeah.
So interesting, right?
Very interesting. Huh.
Sir, now we've come to that one part of this show that I find absolutely profound. Because this is an interesting article that was sent to me personally by a reader. The reader's name is Brando. He brought me this and he linked it to me. And it's from Men's Health. So this is a legitimate article. And he wanted me to bring this out because he is actually an amateur bodybuilder.
Okay.
And he wanted me to put this out there that Arnold Schwarzenegger's 6 best tips for building muscle. So, Brando, hope you're listening. This is for you. Number one, Arnold's number one tip is never forget your start. Kick off any serious training regimen. by taking pictures of yourself in the front, side, and
back. Gotcha. Okay.
Always check back. And every time that you feel that you need inspiration, look at your photos and look at how far you've come. The second tip is get strong first. If you've always wanted big arms, and you'll be tempted to do bicep curls. He goes, but skip them early on. Should I do this in Arnold's voice?
Can you?
No.
Okay.
Skip them early.
Wow, oh, no.
And what was focus. That?
What'd I don't know. What did you say?
I said skip them early on and focus on multi-joint moves.
Skip them like early on. Heads.
Yeah.
And focus on your place. Focus
that's,
on the
that's
front.
That's equally as bad as mine.
Right? Get to the chopper. You got to check out the front and check out the back.
Once you've gained 15 pounds or more of muscle mass, then you're ready to begin adding a variety of exercise to your routine. Number three, chase the pump. The pump, quote unquote, is blood rushing to the muscle. Your training, causing the muscle during your training, causing the muscle to literally swell inside.
Thought he meant chasing his movie, Pumping Iron.
On muscle, it's something you want. Focus on getting that feeling in every workout, even if you're struggling. You can still get a pump to come, even if you focus and concentrate hard enough.
Okay.
Number four, don't be single. Plenty of guys get geeked into doing a single rep at their heaviest weight, but that's not the Arnold way. Instead, do 8 to 12 reps of every set. Why? Powerlifters. No matter how many fibers the weightlifter involves in one maximum lift, he still uses fewer than he would if he uses less weight and did more reps. Hmm. Okay, number five, don't fear the machines. In his heyday, Arnold built around free weights. But as he's gotten older, he's fallen in love with machines. Machines that you have today, you wish you could have used them with what you had back in the day. Don't be afraid to integrate. A shoulder lateral raise machine or a preacher bicep curls machine, just hit those machines at the end after you've gotten two free weight exercises. And lastly, rest like you mean it. Always take one day out of the week where you don't touch a single weight. Go for a nice stroll. Play some sort of activity, but do not touch any weights at all. Save that for Monday. You want to run a marathon? Go ahead. But save the weights back for Monday. I thought that was a pretty interesting article, right?
That is pretty interesting. You know, look, if anyone's going to know how to do it, it's, it's Arnold.
Yep, absolutely. So as, we move on, we are.
What do you got there?
Is this?
What do we got? I think we have our.
Hold on, Larry. Let me just find out who this is.
Well, our mystery guest, sign in, please. Guess we're about to find out. Oh, only a single ring.
Come in.
Oh no! No way!
Wait, is that who I think it is?
It's.
Is that who I think it is?
It's you. What are you doing here? I thought that you. I thought Larry got rid of you when he had his 28. Million.
All right. We don't have to worry about that part.
So wait a minute. You are who told you that this might be the last episode here? Why are you here? Like, what do you have to say to the Yin and Yang galaxy?
I was born in Palermo, Sicily. Came to this country when I was 7. We immigrated to Chicago.
Okay, I understand that, but what does that have to do with anything here?
We were always raised to be very patriotic.
Okay.
Love our country.
Okay.
When I was a little boy, my father took me to a baseball game. They had a martial arts demonstration out there, and I saw this little old Japanese man doing things that I thought were magical.
Ah, oh, sensei.
And developed a crazy dream to go to the Far East. And by the time I was 17, I was there.
Where is the music coming masters.
From? He bought his own music, Larry. What do you want me to do?
Oh, okay. I was curious. It's weird.
I'll be curious, too. What do you want me to do? Okay, well... All right. Well, listen.
You have to pay for that band.
Mr. Seagal, I don't understand what you're doing. Wait a minute.
Oh, he's got that look in his eye.
Oh, my God.
What is he doing? What is he doing? Where is he going?
Oh, my God. What the hell is this? Hold on a second, Larry.
Is he heading for the interns?
Oh,
Where are you going? You see Richie? You see Richie? Oh, I know you. You're Edson. You're Edson. Oh, no, please. Mr. No. Oh, God. No, 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 no. 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 Wait.
Oh, oh. My God. Oh, what is... Oh, it's angry Seagal. Oh. It's very angry.
Oh.
Ooh. Oh. God. Someone's going to be knocking on his door for real. Oh, man. Well, oh, I thought he was gone.
I think he just...
Did he just severely wound Ensign?
Again?
Yeah, he messed him up. He messed him up big time last time.
Oh, okay, okay.
Hey, all right, hey, come on. Let him leave.
Just go in peace. Holy crap.
Look out behind you.
Huh?
Oh. Oh, I saw him coming up on you.
All right, I think he left.
All right. Yeah, he was a pain in the ass when he was living in my kitchen.
Wait, what?
Yeah, remember he was living...
He lived in your kitchen?
Yeah, I remember he went by the name of... I think he went by the name of, like, Hal or something like that. And that may have been the hobo that was just living in my kitchen.
Oh, the hobo.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
Yeah, that wasn't Seagal. I forgot about that. But, yeah, that's crazy. All right, well, there you go, folks.
But I...
Oh, wait a minute. I told you he was behind you. Ah, come on. Where are the other interns? Ant? Oh, man.
All righty then.
Hello, fans, and welcome to another episode, and quite possibly it could be our last episode of Reclaiming You. So, fans, this is a pretty dark day for our podcast, and allow me to just say that if this truly is our last segment together, as a family, as a core group, as a whole, allow me to say that what I had done to change my life, I certainly hope that you'll be able to take with you. Wherever you go and whatever you do, and you know, because this entire segment was to inspire and to really, really show the Yin and Yang galaxy that there is a possible way to change any situation, anything that you've gone through, anything that you are going through. And if you can do that, one of the most important things in the world is just to remember that, you know, if I could take away a few things from this. All these episodes that we've been doing since episode, I think, 44. We've gone through almost 50 episodes of Reclaiming You. And there were some times when I really needed to check my own balance. And there were times when I need to say to myself that I could do better. And there were times that I have said and I've read that so many people have really, really changed their lives bit by bit, step by step, day by day with this episode. And I really, really... I'm very, very proud of that, you know? And so, my friends, I'm going to treat this segment as if this was our very last. And the way that I'm going to do it is, obviously, the first thing I'd like to do is to get you into that proper mindset. So please breathe with me. I'm going to ask of you to please take a good deep breath, fill up your belly with air. Just hold it for a second and slowly release. And let's do it one more time. Let's hold on for a second and then let go. Slowly. There we go. Excellent. So now, my friends, you know, throughout this entire journey, I wanted to say to you that I'm very proud of many of you who have taken the advice I've given you. We've covered so much. And all this is summed up to help you, the listener, to help you get through during the toughest times, during the times where you really need it the most, whenever that is, wherever that is, or with whomever that is. These are the moments that you have to think back and say to yourself that, can I push beyond my limit? Can I really, really take it another step? Am I able to find balance during an unbalanced time? Am I able to find coordination during my most uncoordinated moments? And a bigger question is that after I've reached my goal, you know, after I have fulfilled what I feel is mind, body, and spirit, where do I go from there? Where do I go? How do I maintain? How do I go beyond? That, my friends, is going to be where we leave off, because everyone has their own way. Everyone has their own approach. Everyone has their own, I guess you could say, call to action. And you have to understand, by all means, please, to understand that, you know, one of the most important things in this world is not how you get to the goal, it's what happens after the goal. After you've accomplished it, where do you go a year from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, all the way to the day that you leave this earth? What regrets do you have? What can you change about the now so that you won't regret in the future? These are things that you have to ask yourself at some point. I don't care what it is that you do. It could be you trying to get in better shape. It could be you trying to take care of yourself better. It could be you being a family person, taking care of a family, taking care of young ones. It could be job pressures at work. It could be whatever it may be. All that we've discussed can actually be summed up with the pinnacle of, where do you go from here? And my friends, I feel that we have been ready. We have been, we are much better, you know, than we were from episode 44. I think that, you know, we as a collective group can say to ourselves that over a year later, you know, we can actually say that we've pushed beyond our limit. And if you haven't started yet, there's no time like the now. There's no time better than the now. Think about what it is you want. Go out there and get it. Go out there and do it. One thing is to talk. The other thing is doing. Talking doesn't mean anything. Doing is what matters. There are people who talk about it, and there are people who will be about it. Be about it. So, my friends, if this truly is our last segment together, I thank you for allowing me into your homes. I thank you for allowing me into your office, your car, wherever you're listening this to this. And allow me to say, I thank you, and I hope to see you all again down the road. And may everybody take care of themselves and be well.
You're right over there. Oh, man. What the hell?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I told you he was behind you.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Larry, what the hell happened, man?
He got you, like, in this weird rear naked choke is the only thing I can explain it as.
And, I mean, all I remember.
And he was naked.
I'm sorry?
He had all his clothes off.
Stop. Hey,
I'm not look behind you. Look behind you. His jacket and shirt are still there.
Oh, shit. Oh, my God. It is.
Oh, see? So it was a literal rear naked choke.
Should I?
I think you're fine otherwise.
I get up from the seat. You don't think my butt's going to hurt?
No. It wasn't like that. No, from what I understand, he has more flexibility when he's not restricted by clothing. It's not a sexual thing.
Really? Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But he wanted to prove a point and choke me out.
He did. He seemed like he did prove the point.
Larry, his jacket's still over there.
Yeah, I know. Well, he's gone. I can the door's closed.
What's in the jacket pockets?
Probably a burrito.
Give me 1 second. Let me find out.
Oh, okay. Let's see what we have.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
No way. No way.
What is he rocking?
Larry.
Yeah.
Do you want to split $3,000 with me?
Really? $3K?
And there's also like six different credit cards in here.
Credit cards are traceable. All right. Yeah, look. I mean, you owe me $2,000, but, you know, we can work this out afterwards. We can work this out afterwards.
No. How do I owe you $2,000?
Look, because you do. Of all the times with the show.
And that's not here.
And I wasn't paying for dinner.
No,
all right, look. All right, let's calm down. This is not that type of show. All right, we're here for the people.
All right.
For the people, by the people.
Now, you're a team player, are you not?
I am. I've always have been.
Larry, I need you to help take one for the team.
Okay.
And I need for you to reach into my sack.
Come on. Every week, I'm not doing this. It's bad enough that Seagal was naked.
I will force your hand. I will force
you. Don't. What are you doing? I'm not even in the same room as you. What is going on here?
Oh, really? You don't want to play that game?
Okay. Wang, come here. I also, here's a protein shake. Take Larry's hand and force him to push it down the sack and take. Do it. Just go do it.
Oh, now you're in trouble.
Well, I don't even understand what's going on right now. So, but look, every week, you know, I thought we were doing just a regular podcast. Who the hell is that? It's open. Oh, hey, what are you doing here? Huh? Wait, what? You doing a what? Oh! Wait, what?
Take his hand.
What are you doing with my hands?
Push it in there.
What? No. What is going on? Oh, everything's all pointy and what is that?
Push it in the fucking sack.
What is this?
Push it in there.
Wait a minute. Wait.
I want you to hold on to that, Myra. Hold on to that.
Ah. Something's crawling around.
Look at all that white stuff in there.
Happening? Wow. Oh, did something just bite me? What? Oh, damn it. These are the letters. God damn it.
Biting you, actually.
Oh, Wang's very smooth for some reason. All right. We have a few. Oh, God. We have a few questions for this episode. Okay. Let me know when you're ready.
Give me one moment. Let me just take off my hoodie. See, now I'm all worked up now. You see what I mean?
Well, look, I don't know what to tell you. Turn the heat down in there.
Ready to go. Oh, man. She got me all riled up now, Larry. Now I'm, like, totally into it.
Don't. I don't even want to know anymore.
All right. Here we go. Hit me with those questions there. Right. Hold it on. Hold it in your hand.
It's been a wild 48 minutes. All right, here we go. Aaron Jenks from Cape Coral, Florida asks, I've heard that in the olden days of barefoot arts, people would train in the beach, forest, and even the streets to strengthen their feet. Why is this practice not practiced? And do you feel it matters in today's modern martial arts? I guess it's all about being barefoot.
So, do you know what barefoot arts are?
I'm assuming just being barefoot. You know, right. Walking, running.
It's any martial art that where when you go into a dojo, you do not wear shoes.
I feel like that's majority of them.
I would say that for the most part, like a lot of Japanese arts do not have shoes.
Okay.
A lot of Korean arts do not wear shoes. Now, interestingly enough, Chinese martial arts, you do wear shoes.
I think I've seen that, yeah.
I mean, there are certain things that, you know, you'll notice, like in Brazil, no art has shoes.
Okay.
I mean, you know, things like that, like in America, yeah. You know, boxing, wrestling, all has shoes.
So what are depends, your I thoughts? Guess.
Right. So with the barefoot concept, a lot of the artists that are from certain nations, they come from mainly hot environments. A lot of times it's so that when your feet are under pressure and under heat, you actually can strengthen the bottoms of your feet, like the balls of your foot,
mm-hmm.
you know, the heel, to kick harder because you're strengthening up the skin. So your skin becomes rougher and tougher.
It's like a callus. You're basically building up a callus.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, absolutely. That's why a lot of Chinese martial arts, you're going to see people digging their hands and their fingers into the sand, mm-hmm. Into this hot burning sand or this coal. And it's to strengthen the calluses in your hands and to strengthen, you know, like your palms, and just to strengthen your hand as a whole, because when you punch or when you kick, it's stronger. It's mm-hmm. more lethal that way. So you're generating external power.
Okay.
I could see that. I mean, do I agree with it? Why is the practice not so oftenly practiced now? Well, you have to understand, I don't know about the rest of the world, but in the United States, we have liabilities. We have lawsuits. Yeah. We have litigations where people can file for anything nowadays. This is not the olden days of the 1960s and 70s when they did practice that on a beach. I remember there were some of the older gentlemen who were training in traditional karate. They used to tell me that in the 60s and 70s, what they would do is they would go out into the beach in like sweatsuits and just practice their katas out there in like 90-something degree sun hitting them. You know, with humidity, it's ridiculous. Can't do that now. Somebody passes out of heat stroke, you're deep shit.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know?
So that's my take on it.
All right. What do we got here? Joey Jojo, at Joey what? Jojo.
He should just add Joey Jojo J. He's going to shut. But okay.
Yeah, right. Writes, do you feel the East Coast and West Coast martial arts schools have better ways of training and why? I'm more curious about the Seattle martial arts scene. I think we can talk about that at a different time.
Really? Why?
You know, I've heard things that the Seattle group a little tougher than the LA group, especially for those who may have a poster of Bruce Lee in their gymnasium. So this is what I'm just hearing. This is what I'm hearing.
Really?
Yeah.
This I have to find out myself. I'm going to do some research on that, Larry, and we'll get back to you on that one. Right?
You know, I heard their motto: "No retreat, no surrender."
Really?
But what do you
think? That's a pretty good motto.
East Coast, West Coast.
Well, I mean, the East Coast scene. Well, you got to understand something. In the West Coast, things are a lot more lax. People don't take things like in New York. If you look, I think a lot of it has to do with just cultural background. A lot of it has to do with just everyday life. You know, mm-hmm. New Yorkers are rushing everywhere. We're moving fast. We're, you know, I mean, you know, the way that we do things out here is that everything's just constantly go, 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 go. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, it's like if you look at L.A., everything's just more laid back. You know, you do hustle in certain points in your life, but throughout the day. But, you know, it's like the people's mentality is a lot more lax. And I'm not saying slacker type lax, but it's a lot more easier going. So whereas somebody wants to go into a dojo here in New York and they just want to just run through the motions, get through the class about an hour or so, mm-hmm. they got shit to do. You know, people in LA don't have that kind of a mentality. You know, also, you know, once again, the training year round. You can train in a beach every single day. You can't do that in New York because we have winters. Who's going to go out there and run? You know, I mean, you could run during hot weather as long as you keep yourself hydrated. You can't run out in like 10-degree weather, 20-degree weather.
True.
What happens if there's a blizzard? So, you know, also keep in mind that your joints work better in the heat than they do in the cold. Mm-hmm. So you're a lot more flexible. You don't cramp up. So, you know, people within that, you know, that type of weather or that type of climate have a very different outlook. So there's a lot of things that are different between the East and West Coast, you know? So, but I think a lot of it is mentality and approach.
Good. All righty. Jana Fernanda from Sao Paulo, Brazil says, Larry, it doesn't sound like you eat a lot of food that's not American. I invite you to try Rosito. Have Anthony take you.
What?
Rosito?
Pretty sure spell it for me.
I'm pretty sure I saw that monster in the Godzilla sequel.
Spell it for me,
please. R-O-D-I-Z-I-O.
Rodizio. Rodizio.
Okay.
Do you know what that is?
Absolutely not.
No, actually, what is the rest of it?
Have Anthony take you.
First of all, Jenna, if that's her name, Fernanda. I will never step into another restaurant with Larry again, considering the idea that he almost walked out on the bill the last time. Secondly, Larry,
I would have. You owe me. You owe me, motherfucker. All right, you owe me. All right,
relax. That's not the. What? That's not the.
Oh wait, Huang is still here. Oh.
Oh, good. He's out. Okay. So, fans, in case you don't know, Larry has been to a Rodizio, and I will prove it to you right now because when our good friend Yari had his bachelor party. That restaurant that we went to in Queens when we were in suits, yeah, that was a Brazilian Rodizio.
Oh.
Let's just put it this way. I have never seen a human being eat the way that Larry did that day. It was unreal. Oh, glorious. Jaw. Even the chefs would look at him like, what in the living hell? My Larry, you all right over there?
Damn, Joe, what's the matter with you? I don't even know what you're saying. Oh, so, no, I've never eaten Brazilian food. I don't think I will.
Yes, you have.
I'm just not interested.
Yes, you have. During Yari's bachelor party, remember where we went before we went to the strip?
I thought that was what? Well, to the New York strip
mall.
Yeah, exactly. Wasn't that a Brazilian,
that was a Brazilian Rodizio. That was a barbecue joint.
Oh, is that what that is?
It's the unlimited meats.
Oh, I like that. I like that food. That was good food. I ate a lot that day.
You see, Brazilian people are cool, man.
All right. Tainara Conti. All right. So, Kenneth Eberly writes.
Too much MST3K.
What's up, fellas? Great work on the show, but Anthony, don't let Larry get to you. What?
Yeah, exactly. That's a good man right there. I'll read the rest of it.
We all know who runs this mother effer, and it ain't Larry. Well, I'm not reading this. I refuse to read this.
A fan who I have respect for, a fan who knows the truth.
You know what, Kenneth? Kenneth, you are banned from the show, Kenneth. That's it. You are banned from the show. I am disqualifying your letter. I am disqualifying your question.
Kenneth, I got you, dude. Don't worry about it.
You are never. I am putting it in the code. You are never going to be listening to any one of my podcasts, whether it's Retro Gamers Podcast every Tuesday, the Yin and Yang Podcast every Friday, the Better Half Podcast every other Wednesday, Talking More Wrestling, the Ring Crew,
Kenneth
More Pop Everly Vinyls.
Writes, what's up,
wait,
fellas?
Great
work on the show, but Larry, don't let Larry get to you. We all know who runs this motherfucker, and it ain't Larry. So here's my question, fellas. I'm an avid gym goer, and I've noticed that the last few weeks or months, well, I don't know, much more and more people have been taking videos of themselves doing sets and reps and exercises. Do you think this is being used for good or bad? Because I feel, goddamn, this is a long one. Because I feel like it's a disturbing trend. At the same time, does this whole video concept exist in martial arts and sports as well? What is your opinion on this? Okay. Well, Larry's completely out like a light because Huang is just basically paintbrushing his face, right? I think maybe Larry – no, Larry's out. Anyway, so Kenneth, it can be used for good or bad. Now, is it a disturbing trend? Well, you got to understand, you know, you would have never seen this 20 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, maybe even 30 years ago. You would have never seen something like this in any capacity of somebody filming it unless it's professional, okay? Let's understand the fact that we live in a world now where we have communicative devices. People are recording anything and everything just to basically get a rise out of somebody, just to get popularity, just to gain attention, whatever it may be. Now, don't get me wrong. I was always encouraged, and I encourage my students that if you want to take a video of your kata, if you want to take a video of your form, if you want to take a video of your sparring, if you want to take a video of whatever, do it for the purpose of wanting to improve yourself and seeing what you're doing wrong. It's not meant for you to put that on your phone, put that on social media, or to show your friends, oh, look at how cool I am. I'm doing martial arts. Now, then again, you could also say that there's an opposite end of the spectrum. You look at professional athletes. Why is it that they put everything up on Facebook? They want popularity. They want attention. They want whatever. Okay? These things do happen. Now, so it's really a matter of you using it for good or bad. Which one are you doing? So completely, completely up to you. And fans, if you have any questions, Well, write to us at yinandyangpodcast@gmail.com. Once again, yinandyangpodcast@gmail.com. I'm not sure if we're going to actually continue this. It depends on whether we get 10 downloads and 10 listens for this week. Let's see where we go from there. You have any promotions? Of course you do. You just promoted the living hell out of all your shows.
Yeah, I did that part.
Do you really need to do it again? Okay, fine. Then you have no promo time now. Okay. Now, Larry, what is our
every next Tuesday, the Retro Gamers Podcast. You can check it out. You can listen to it wherever you listen to podcasts.
La, 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 la.
Mute his mic. Mute his mic. Every Tuesday, the Retro Gamers Podcast. You can actually watch us on YouTube because the Retro Gamers has a YouTube page where you can watch all the podcasts. Every other Wednesday, the Better Half Podcast.
Just la, 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 la.
Damn it.
And
that is racist. That is racist.
How is that racist?
That is racist. Okay. All right. I take offense to that.
This coming from you?
What? How dare you? Do you have? Do you eat? Oh no, you're not Jewish. Never mind.
Just so white and dirty.
Do you eat Jewish food on Christmas?
I wouldn't mind. They have good Jewish delis.
Cat's Deli, which is closed.
Heck, hell yeah. I would do that on Christmas. Why not?
Milbasin Deli. Oh.
They're onion rings. On the shit.
Oh, forget about it. I just had that a couple days ago. And I'm going to be... this weekend I'll be making an appearance I got to check my notes. Some steak joint in Brooklyn.
Some what? Steak joint? Is it called Peter Luger's?
Nope.
What's is it a one? Place where I should be? Park Slope Steakhouse?
Nope. Oh my god, why can't I remember it?
Roland Roaster?
No, it's a good steakhouse.
Bread and Car?
No. Oh my god.
Anyway, fans.
Oh no, I failed myself. Ugh.
And the other... because you know why you don't remember it? Because you're going to try to figure out a way to get out of the bill. Isn't that right, Larry?
No.
Anyway, so fans, allow me to say that, as I had said, this week's episode is serious. It means a lot. This is going to be a very important piece that I think our fate is going to be decided by you listening. So fans, please do me a favor. Let's get double digits. At least we need 10 downloads and 10 plays on Spreaker alone. Help a brother out, man. So anyway.
I think we can do that.
I hope so. So Larry, do you have anything to add before we go?
No. I think this was really good. I think this was a good episode. Harken back to days of yore, and I'm looking forward to 3 more episodes.
Well, this is episode 98.
I'm looking forward to 2 more episodes.
Oh, so you're not counting it down?
No, I'm just saying. And then you know, if we make it to 100, then you know things might change. So this is going to be good. This is going to be good,
Larry. Sometimes I feel a little doubtful about this, but you know what, man? If this is our last episode, I want to personally say thank you for giving me the opportunity to get on this craziness where I can spew the bullshit out of my brain, as Steve Austin would say. I'd like to thank you for really giving me my start in the podcasting world. I want to also say to you that, you know, we've gained a good amount of notoriety, you know, while we were there. You know, for this amount of time, for over 2 years. At the same time, you know, it's opened doors to other things too, which is pretty awesome. By the way, did you know that when I was traveling to Pittsburgh, I was on 93.7 The Fan on Pittsburgh radio?
Really? For what?
Yeah. I was talking about the game and, you know, just...
Did you drop the podcast?
I did not. I'm sorry. That was actually an on-air call. I could not give out any promos. I was actually told that before I got on the air, if you can imagine.
But it's live. You could have.
I could have. You know, but there will be hopefully other opportunities.
Yep. That's why I do shows. Like, I've done the Newman Show. I'm doing the Ring Crew. I've done Monty and the Pharaoh. I get the podcast out there. So it's okay. We got it. Synergy.
So, Larry, I guess there's only one thing left to say, and I haven't said this in a long, long
time. It's been a minute, yeah.
So, ladies and gentlemen, what we ask of you is to please listen, download, spread it out to everybody that you know. And with that said, ladies and gentlemen, if this is truly our last episode, I thank you, the listener. I thank you. Even though there were times when I was frustrated and I was upset, thank you for always being there for me. Thank you for being there for Larry. Thank you for being there for us, listening to, giving us your time, listening to the show. So without further ado, I'd like to say, please take care of yourselves. Work out. Eat right. Your body is your temple. Use your left and right turn indicators. Erase the racism. Eliminate the hate. Let there be peace in this world. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, so much from the bottom of our hearts. For all the interns, myself, Larry included, we just want to say, tally-ho!
Kind of hope that maybe in a way that we don't get the listens, you know, because if we don't get the listens, then that's it. We're done. I'm done. I just, why is this red light still on?